Gates, ladies and gentlemen, our conference Freedom Online in Tunis comes to the end. This is the start of the closing ceremony. We are pleased to have His Excellency Mr. Nadir Ben Ammou, the Minister of Justice of Tunisia, and of course, a lot of personalities around this, and honorable delegates from the coalition members and our friend from Iraq and Jordan and Libya participated in this closing ceremony too. We had 2 and 4 days, let me say, because we have 2 days for pre-events for this conference. It was really important conference for us, as I mentioned in the closing ceremony. And today we are really happy and glad because we see the involvement of the civil society in this conference, because we see a lot of good debates and really rewarding debates on the subjects like surveillance, like privacy, like different responsibilities from each stakeholders. And this is for us real. We need to raise our appreciation for this. We had 485 participants of this conference registered for this conference, and 200, more than 200 are from outside of Tunisia, and we have more than 150 from the civil society. Hackers, bloggers, students came to participate to this conference, and there was really, really important for them to participate to the debate here. Also, a lot of persons from the operators, from the ISPs, came especially for different subjects and tried to understand and to be involved in the global debate. It's really a honor for us, and we're really pleased to have this, all those debates. And I would like to, after this, to welcome Mr. Andrew Budapest, the chair of the steering committee of this conference, to address the final report of the outcomes of this conference. But before that, I would like to thank him for all the hard work he did with all the steering committee members. This is important for us to have this kind of content in the conference in Tunis, especially in Tunis, because human rights is a global topic. Thank you. Welcome.
Thanks very much, Mois. And firstly, on behalf of myself, and I think of all of the international participants, I want to thank Mois and his team, the government of Tunisia, and actually the people of Tunisia for making us all feel so welcome here in your wonderful country. We've really appreciated all our time here and look forward to following events here and coming back again for social events as well as work. So thank you very much, people of Tunisia. It's been wonderful. I can't summarise all the outcomes of the conference. We'll do a full report in the next few days, which we'll make available. I just want to highlight a few themes that have emerged, I think, that are worth reflecting on in the wider plenary. The first is, what is the value of the coalition, the Freedom Online Coalition? There are lots of internet meetings. There are lots of international meetings. There are lots of opportunities for people to shout at governments, for governments to talk to each other, for businesses to meet and lobby, for civil society to gather. I think the value of the coalition is the opportunity to bring together a group of like-minded governments with civil society groups and businesses to constructively sit down together and think about how we can jointly promote freedom of expression, economic development, openness, and democracy online. That to me is the key message of the coalition. It's a different way of doing things, a different way of meeting and exchanging and sharing ideas. And that implies, as I think has already come out of the chairman's statement on behalf of the governments, that the coalition should have an existence outside of these meetings. It shouldn't simply disappear between now and the forthcoming meeting in Estonia. So the conference was structured around 3 distinct work themes: an internet free and secure, access and affordability, and privacy and transparency. And within those themes, we think a number of clear issues have emerged that could form the content of working groups that could go forward from here to Estonia. It means us thinking a bit more about the institutional structure of the coalition, discussing with governments how they want to involve businesses and civil society in some of those policy discussions. What is the kind of connective tissue that holds things together? We think there should be meetings of coalition member states at all the significant internet policy forums to help coordinate policy and thinking. We think within each meeting there should be the space for governments and civil society and businesses to sit down to strategize about the common problems and threats they see emerging in the years ahead. So there's a number of things we're going to recommend that I think will help glue the coalition more firmly together as a living instrument. Within the overall themes, we spent a lot of time talking about security and human rights. And I think the conclusion of the participants here is there is no necessary contradiction between security and human rights. For people to have their human rights, they need to be secure. That means you have to navigate and negotiate difficult issues like surveillance, like policing, like the protection of freedom of speech, and the clashes and intersections between them. And we think there's some work the coalition can do in helping shape collective thinking and principles in that field. And we think it's important to emphasize throughout that transparency should be a key part of how governments seek to maintain some of those delicate balances. And I think a consistent theme that emerged here, one I think very appropriate to Tunisia given the events it's gone through, is the theme and importance of transparency. On the question of access, I think we fundamentally believe as a coalition that unless people have access to the internet, and unless that access is affordable and equitable, then it's fairly meaningless to talk about human rights and freedom online if people can't get online in the first place. So thinking about the right technical investments to make to secure low-cost infrastructure is something where the thinking and experience and knowledge within the coalition could be of tremendous value to developing countries and to new members. We think there's an important area of relatively technical regulation where, again, there's a lot of experience within the coalition that could be brought to bear to help governments or advise governments on shaping policies that deliver that crucial issue of access. And one of the themes that has emerged here, I think, more than others, is the importance of the role of women, the women having access to the internet. The internet is still a male-dominated medium, and women are still relatively minor users of that medium. So thinking throughout, not just in one section, but throughout all of these policy issues, security, access, and privacy and transparency, how women are unable to take part in using the internet, seems to us a crucial thing. Where again, there's an opportunity for some really creative thinking on behalf of the coalition. In relation to privacy and transparency, I think we flagged up a couple of areas. There's in the area of the RUGI principles, which have had widespread support among the business community. There's probably some more work to do on access to remedies, the third part of RUGI that says when there is a human rights violation, how do the companies respond? That's something where we think a multi-stakeholder discussion of government, civil society, and business could provide some very useful thinking. We think it's an opportunity to think about transparency in the private sector as well, the kind of challenges that companies face, the kind of requirements governments place on them, and how that fits within the overall objective of transparency. And I think something that came through as a consistent theme for me is the importance of the technical expertise that we've gathered in this room. There's a lot of people who know a lot about the internet and how it works. That's a tremendous resource that could be made available to the member states, to the civil society representatives, and to other governments who may be interested in associating themselves with a coalition. I'm sorry I can't do justice to everything. That's a broad heading. We'll get the report out as soon as we can, and I think there'll be a lot of valuable work to carry forward to the next meeting in Estonia, where I hope to see all of you again in the future. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Andrew. It was really good to hear that all those outcomes will be also published very soon in the website. Next, I will welcome Ms. Salwa Ghazouani from Article 19, who will present a report on net freedom about Tunisia. So welcome, Salwa.
Thank thank you, Mr. Moaz, and hello, everyone. Sorry, I will speak in Arabic. مساء الخير. مساء الخير جميعاً. سأقدم لكم هذه الوثيقة المرجعية حول القوانين المنظمة للإنترنت في تونس، وهي ثمرة ونتاج جهد قام به المكتب الدولي للمادة 19 في لندن والمكتب الوطني في تونس، وهي نتاج دراسة شاملة لحرية التعبير على الإنترنت على مستوى القوانين وكذلك على مستوى الممارسات. في هذه الوثيقة المرجعية فحص لمدى تطابق وتلاؤم المنظومة التشريعية المنظمة للإنترنت في تونس مع القوانين الدولية، وكذلك مجموعة من الاستنتاجات والخلاصات والتوصيات التي لن آتي على ذكرها كلها، ولكن سأتطرق إلى البعض منها. والوثيقة موجودة بالنسبة للناطقين باللغة الفرنسية في نسخة ورقية خارج القاعة، وستكون متوفرة على الإنترنت على موقع ويب المنظمة article19.org باللغتين الإنجليزية والعربية. من الاستنتاجات والخلاصات التي خرجت بها هذه الدراسة هو أن يعني المنظومة التشريعية التي كانت تنظم الإنترنت في العهد السابق هي نفسها، لا تزال هي المعمول بها، وهي بالتالي تحتاج إلى المراجعة وإلى يعني إصلاح، يعني يجب أن يطال قطاع الإنترنت في تونس على مستوى القوانين وكذلك ربما على مستوى المؤسسات. من الاستنتاجات كذلك هو أن يعني حماية حرية التعبير يجب أن يراعي تلك المعادلة الصعبة والمعقدة بين حماية حرية التعبير وفي نفس الوقت حماية الحياة الخاصة واحترام الحياة الخاصة. كذلك تثمن المادة 19 في هذه الوثيقة غياب قوانين تنظم بعض جوانب استعمال الإنترنت كاستعمال المدونين وصحفي المواطنة للإنترنت، وتعتبر أن هذه أن صحافة المواطنة والتدوين هي تدخل في إطار القوانين المنظمة للنشر بصفة عامة، وبالتالي لا ليس هناك حاجة لإصدار قوانين تنظم التدوين وتنظم صحافة صحافة المواطنة. هناك يعني العديد من التوصيات في هذه الدراسة التي هي كان للخبراء التونسيين في القانون دور كبير، على رأسهم الدكتور عبد القادر فتح الله، هو ليس بيننا ولكنني استسمحكم لأتوجه له بتحية شكر، وكذلك خبراء آخرون يعني في مجالات أخرى كان لهم دور في يعني تصحيح وتعديل بعض هذه الاستنتاجات قبل أن تصدر الدراسة. شكرا للمنظمين على إتاحة هذه الفرصة، وأدعو كل من يتقن اللغة الفرنسية إلى اقتناء نسخة من خارج القاعة. شكرا.
Thank you very much, Salwa. Yeah, a hard copy will be available in outside, so you can pick it up. Next, I will welcome Mr. Sami Ben Gharbia, representative of the civil society participating in this conference, to read a declaration or a statement on their behalf. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I would like first to thank civil society for choosing me on behalf of NAWAD to read this call. So this is a call to governments from civil society. This call captures the sense of the room at the justice stand last night at NAWAD headquarters in Al Qasbah. In the light of recent event of number of civil society organizations participating in this coalition meeting, call on government who are members of the Freedom Online Coalition to commit to the following. Recognize that they are responsible for protecting the human rights of all people, not just those of their own citizens. Freedom Online Coalition members should review their policies and practices to ensure that they adhere to this principle. Render any law, regulation, or legal interpretation related to monitoring and surveillance of online communications and connections accessible and foreseeable to the public. Secret law is not the law. make transparent the scope and nature of requests to service providers related to surveillance of online communications, and not prohibit public disclosure to users by these service providers. Improve understanding within national governments on the implication of surveillance for digital freedoms and the relation of trust between states and citizens. The explosion of digital communication content and information about communication or communications metadata, the falling cost of storing and mining large sets of data, and the provision of personal content through third-party service providers make state surveillance possible at an unprecedented scale. Broad coalition of site information not only has a chilling effect on free expression and association, it threatens confidence in the internet as a safe platform for personal communication. It is therefore incumbent upon Freedom Online Coalition member to extend and defend fundamental rights in ways that respond to this changing environment. In taking this commitment forward, we urge Freedom Online Coalition members to adopt, comply with, and implement the international principles on the application of human rights to communication surveillance published in June 7, 2013 by civil society groups active in the Freedom Online Coalitions. These principles address the following: legality, legitimate aim, necessity, adequacy, proportionality, transparency, public oversight, integrity of communication and systems, safeguards of international cooperation, for user safeguards against illegitimate access. Widespread and targeted surveillance and data collection is not consistent with these principles. These principles, the concept of privacy by design, and the international human rights framework should also be applied to the technical architecture of communication and surveillance systems, ensuring that technological and policy protections are developed in parallel. We see the Freedom Online Coalition as a platform for constructive multi-stakeholder debate on these issues and look forward to working with the Freedom Online Coalition to take substantive steps to advance these goals and report back on progress made at the Internet Governance Forum in Bali and the 2014 Freedom Online Conference in Tallinn. Thank you.
Thank you, Sammy, for this statement. It will be published soon in the website of the Freedom Online Coalition, for sure. Next, I will welcome Mr. Janus from Estonia, because Estonia will host the next conference, so yeah, we will welcome him. Welcome. Yeah. What can I say? You will say everything.
Yeah, welcome. Thank you, Masha. Yeah.
Dear colleagues, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, representative of civil society, also participants, and so else. First of all, I would like to thank Tunisian partners, Moesha Souk, his team, all the organizing of this event. It was excellent. Also, steering committee, NGOs, you make a great job. Estonia will continuing the way started by Netherlands, Kenya, and Tunisia. We organize the next 2014 Freedom Online Conference in Tallinn. Free and secure internet will be one of the key times of the next year conference in Estonia. We will also discuss other main topics such as freedom of expression in the internet, unrestricted access and use of the internet, privacy, transparency of the internet, and cooperation between the public and private sectors. I hope to see you all in Tallinn and welcome to my country. Thank you very much.
It's beautiful. I really want to go there. Okay. Before asking and welcoming His Excellency Minister of Justice to close officially this conference, I would like to highlight something very important for me. You know, this conference was like a challenge for us. Nobody believed before that Tunisia could really organize this kind of conference about freedom online before, and we made it. Not me, or not ITI, or the government of Tunisia, civil society made it. They did a lot for us. They did a lot for this conference. Believe me, I would never, never, never do this conference, organize this conference without them. I will name two persons, especially Duha bin Youssef and Karim bin Abdullah, who played an important role. Of course, a lot of persons, other from civil society, helped them and supported them and worked with them all night to make this conference come through. But especially those two persons played a very, very important role. And of course, our sponsors, our partners, I would really like to welcome them and to thank you, to thank them for their belief, to trust they give us to make this conference on. So, by this, I would like to also to introduce the video for the closing ceremony. Welcome. Yes. The video? Yeah. Yeah.
Zuhair, which is the first blogger who was arrested and died in 2005. So that made me angry against the system.
La liberté sur internet, j'essaie de définir que c'est une projection, c'est-à-dire lorsqu'on passe du monde réel à la monde, au monde virtuel.
Freedom of expression is about letting people express their opinions regardless of what your opinions are. I think that the majority of people present here dream of a free internet.
يخدموا خدمتهم نحن نخدموا خدمتنا كاو يخدم خدمتك الكل اي واحد شاد كرسي اي واحد عنده بوفوار يخدم خدمته كاو ما يتعداش على غيره طب نحن ما يراو منا كانوا به خاطرك باش تعدي على غيره كانوا تعدى علينا خاطر كي ما تعدى على ذاك باش تعدى علينا نهار اخر
They tried because this was the last minute work, so no problem. At least they tried. But you can see here the 404 lab, which was inaugurated by this, also by, as an outcome of this conference. Okay, His Excellency Mr. Nadir bin Amo, so welcome to this floor and to address the closing. Welcome.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم شكرا للمنظمين لهذا المؤتمر على الدعوة لاختتامه وشكرا أيضا على اختيار تونس لاحتضان هذا المؤتمر حرية التعبير عبر الإنترنت ربما كان هذا المفهوم من المفاهيم الخيالية قبل سنوات مضت، أي قبل ثورة 14 جانفي. أن نتحدث عن إنترنت في ذلك الزمن أو قبل ذلك الزمن، نعم كان موجودا بالفعل، ولكن نتحدث عن حرية، حرية التعبير عبر هذه الوسيلة، فربما كان ذلك من ضرب الخيال. كلنا نعلم أن تونس كانت من أكثر الدول قمعا لهذه الحرية. كلنا نعلم أيضا أن الحرية لا تمنح، وقد بينت الوقائع أن الحرية لابد أن تفتك، ولاحظ كلنا أن حرية التعبير كانت المحرك الأساسي حتى تنطلق ثورات الشعوب في العالم العربي انطلاقا من تونس. لكن قد يكون هناك مبالغة، أن ما وقع في تونس كان وليد لحظة زمنية، أن ما وقع في تونس هو نتيجة تراكمات لتطور التكنولوجيا الذي أدى إلى تطور سلوكيات وعقليات. لم يكن من السهل أن تجمع الآلاف من المواطنين في الساحات دون هذه التقنية، ودون الاقتناع بأن هذه التقنية يكون لها دور فعال ودور أساسي، دور حول وجهة التاريخ في بلادنا. تراكمات نتيجة لما يسمى بتطور اللامادية. اللامادية تأسست إثرها الثقافة، la culture de l'immatériel، وترجم ذلك على مستوى وجود الحقوق والحريات، وليس وجودها فقط بل ممارستها. في اعتقادي أن منظومة الحريات وحقوق الإنسان لا تتغير في جوهرها بتغير الأساليب، بتطورها من أساليب للتعبير مادية إلى أساليب لا مادية أو غير مادية. لكن هذا التطور يجب أن يدعم هذه الحريات وهذه الحقوق. هذا التطور يجب أن يجعل هذه الحريات وهذه الحقوق مواكبة للتطور التكنولوجي، بمعنى أنه إذا كان هناك تطور تكنولوجي فلا يجب أن يعبر ذلك عن عكس في الحماية، بل الأمر على خلافه، يجب أن يقع تطوير هذه الحماية. ولعلكم فهمتم أن تطوير هذه الحماية يقتضي التقليص ويقتضي تقنين الرقابة، باعتبار أن تلك الرقابة ضرورية ولكنها يجب أن تكون بدورها مقننة. في نفس الوقت هذا التطور التكنولوجي يؤدي إلى ظهور وسائل غير معهودة ووقائع جديدة لابد أن يحتضنها القانون. نحن نعلم أن الوقائع في تطور مستمر، وأن القانون كما يقال يجري وراءها حتى يتمكن من تأطيرها. إذن نلاحظ أن القوانين، ومثل ما ذكر منذ قليل، القانون الوطنية تسعى دائما وأبدا في تطوير الظواهر المادية، لكن ظهور الإنترنت أدى إلى استحالة احترام الحدود المادية للدول. هذه إشكالية من الإشكاليات. إذا أمكن أن نسيطر على ظاهرة على المستوى القانوني في إطار الحدود الوطنية، فإن السيطرة على تلك الظاهرة غير ممكن إذا ما تجاوزت الحدود، أي إذا ما عبرت الدول. وهذه الظواهر في والتطورات التكنولوجية والتي تؤدي إلى تطوير في الحقوق وفي الحرية في ممارستها تفضي في الوجه المقابل إلى اعتداءات على هذه الحقوق وعلى هذه الحريات، وتطرح إشكالات فيما يتعلق بتتبع الأشخاص الذين يعتدون على هذه الحقوق، حقوق الغير وحريته. إشكالات طرحت فيما يتعلق بالجرائم المنظمة والجرائم يسمى الجرائم العابرة للقارات وجرائم الإرهاب، كل هذا يطرح إشكال الموازنات بين ضرورة احترام الحقوق الفردية واحترام الحريات ومن حرية التعبير واحترام السلامة والاستقرار. إذن هناك ضرورة في أن يوجد توازن بين ضمان الحريات والحقوق من ناحية وضمان احترام حقوق الغير والنظام العام من ناحية أخرى. أعلم أنكم أرهقتم بمقتضى الأشغال التي كنتم فيها وأن الاختتام ينتظر بفارغ صبر، ولكن أقول إنه ليس من باب الصدفة أن تدعى وزارة العدل لاختتام هذا المؤتمر. وزارة العدل هنا تأتي ليس لسؤالها عن وقائع أو عن قضايا، إنما تأتي نتيجة لدورها، دورها أقول الطبيعي أو العادي في سن القوانين. والسؤال هل يجب قوانين لتأطير الحريات، حرية التعبير بالأساس؟ هل هناك قوانين كثيرة؟ هل يجب أن نزيد على هذه القوانين؟ هل نحن بحاجة إلى قوانين؟ أغتنم هذه المناسبة لأقول إنه لا يجب في كل الأحوال انتظار التشريعات، يجب أن لا ننتظر القوانين، وهذا هو في الواقع مفهوم الحرية أو معنى الحرية، أن نكون ممتلكين أو أن نكون أصحاب حرية في التعبير، فمن باب حماية هذه الحرية أن لا ندع المشرع يتدخل أو أن لا نحث المشرع على التدخل، بالعكس أن نترك المشرع بعيدا. ستقولون لماذا؟ هذا من باب ما يقولون إنه من قواعد حسن السلوك أو من منتوج ما يسمى بمدونات حسن السلوك. هذه المدونات التي لا تقوم على قواعد تشريعية، التشريع الذي يقوم على القاعدة القانونية التي تنتظر جزاءها عند وقوع مخالفتها، لكن أن يكون الشخص متمتعا بحرية ما، أن يمارسها في إطار حدود هو الذي يضعها، هو الذي يتفق مع غيره على وضعها. لماذا؟ لأنه في كل مرة يترك المجال واسعا لممارسة حرية دون قيود شخصية ذاتية إلا وكان المشرع متدخلا بالضرورة. وتعلمون أن في كل مرة يتدخل المشرع إلا ويكون متدخله قاسيا بقدر ما يستطيع أو على قدر ما يحاول أن تكون قواعده ملطفة، فإنه من باب الضرورة ومن باب النتيجة أنه إذا تدخله سيكون مجردا غير لين غير طيئا إلى الضرورات. بالتالي الدعوة تكون أن كل شخص يقيد حريته بذاته، أن كل شخص مع غيره في نطاق هذه الحرية يتقيد مع الآخرين حتى لا يجعل المشرع يتدخل بهذه القسوة التي قد تفقد هذه الحرية معناها أو قد تفقدها كاملة. لن أطيل عليكم وأقول لكم إلى اللقاء في أستونيا.
Thank you so much. I think the conference is closed. Thank you very much. At least it's finished.